This is my fifth visit to Kuwait, and always I try to deliver some lectures, and I'm always happy if somebody arrives to listen to me. Because you understand, in my age, it is important to give much more, not to bring it to heaven, because I don't know, will I be admitted there or not? So I try my best. My lecture today is not simple about Vasco da Gama, because Vasco da Gama voyage is published in many school textbooks, in schools, and so on and so on. I try to explain why, what happened, why this small, insignificant Portugal suddenly became the greatest colonial power. And this, for this, I needed a lot of research in archives, studying books, publications, so that to bring you something new. Because if I will say the same, so nobody will invite me again. Therefore, I ask you for patience, because this problem is extremely difficult and complicated. And because time is pressing, so usually I deliver lectures free, but now I prefer to read, because then it will be a little shorter. 500 years ago, the 8th of July, 1497, a squadron of four ships lifted their anchor in the port of Lisboa and started their way to the Atlantic Ocean. This was the beginning of the famous voyage of Vasco da Gama, which resulted in the opening of the uninterrupted seaway, sea route from Europe to India. Together with Christopher Columbus, discovery of America in 1492, Magellan's first voyage around the globe in 1520, their travels considered the greatest event of so-called epoch of great geographical discoveries in the 15th, 16th century. This is stated, as I told, in all textbooks printed in Europe, United States, and some other countries. But some question inevitable emerge. For whom were these geographical discoveries so great? For Arabs, Indians, Persians, Chinese scholars and sailors, who more than 2,000 years before crossed in their ships Indian and part of Pacific Oceans. From Red to Yellow Sea, from Egypt to Malacca, from Bahrain and Aden to China and even Korea, who crossed Mediterranean from Morocco and Spain to Alexandria and Cyprus. Or they were great an opening for creators of great famous empires of Alexander of Macedonia, Arab caliphates, Umayyad and Abbasid, empires of Chinggis Khan and Timur, the great Indian and Malayan sea empires, Maurya, Chola, Srivijaya, and Majapahit. Or to the creator of great civilization of America, Aztecs, Incas, and Mayas. Then it is important to explain who helped Spain and the insignificant in the Middle Ages Portugal not only to make so many discoveries, but to create the first in modern times colonial empires, which couldn't organize the great European powers like France, England, and so on. Of course, to answer this and connected question in full is necessary to deliver a whole course of lectures. And inshallah, somebody will deliver them before the 21st century. My humble task today is only to try to explain in short these important events in the framework of the history of world civilization of 12th, 16th century. The short review of this period is necessary. The end of 11th, beginning 12th century was marked by great changes in military, political, economic and social situation in the vast region between Mediterranean and Caspian Seas, between Caucasus and Persian Gulf, between Nile and Volga. The Seljuks inflicted a very heavy blow on the great Abbasid Caliphate. At the same time, began a deep crisis of Byzantium Empire. These events were quickly used by the great European powers, France, England, and so-called Holy Roman Empire of German nation, and of course, by Vatican, of whose role I will speak much more. They organized the infamous Crusades. As a result of First Crusade, 1097-99, the Christian Jerusalem Kingdom and earldoms of Edessa and Antiochia were created. The reasons and results are described in many books, including my monograph, The West Against the Muslim East, From Crusades Up to Today, which was published in Arabic in 1985. To prove that I am not lying, I brought the last copy of this book. It's here. This was a very heavy blow to the ancient trade routes, silk, paper roads, sea routes which connected Far East, Southeast Asia, South Asia, and Near East with Europe. But the life of Jerusalem Kingdom and earldoms was short. Cruel exploitation of local population, mainly Muslims, fights between crusaders, differences between European powers and Vatican, the intrigues of Venice and Genoa, all this made the situation unstable. At the same time, grew up the opposition of the new Fatimid Caliphate in Egypt. The Muslim states saw in the existence of Jerusalem Kingdom a grave menace to their prestige and economic development. To strengthen the position of Jerusalem Kingdom and these small earldoms in general, and to strengthen the European position in the Near East, it was decided to begin the Second Crusade, which was performed in 1147-49 under the leadership of King of France Louis VII and German Emperor Conrad III. This brutal invasion became a disaster. It was a great blow on prestige of Christianity, Europe, and Vatican. In those circumstances, a very strange, even exceptional event in world history occurred. Approximately in 1150, a prolonged message addressed to the Emperor of Byzantium Empire, Mikhail Komnin, appeared in Constantinople. It was signed by a person with a strange title and name, Priester John. It was stated in the letter that the author is King of Kings, ruler of three Indians, master of 72 kings. He stressed that every day at his dinner are present 30,000 high officials. He proclaimed himself a Christian and mentioned that some of his subjects are also Christian. Priest Jones informed that he smashed many mighty Muslim states, and with a huge army is staying on the shores of Tigris, awaiting the possibility to cross the river and to start an assault on the Muslim forces from the east. German medieval historian Otto von Freisingen noted in his chronicle that the letter of Priest John made an extremely great impression in Constantinople, and that copies of it were immediately sent to Pope Alexander and to the German Emperor Friedrich Barbarossa. At the time of gloom in Europe, the attacks on Palestine from the east and south, the letter of Priest Jones was a real booster of morale. Notwithstanding of all fantastic assurances in this document, Pope Alexander III sent in 1177 an official reply blessing the mysterious priest John and asking him to attack as quick as possible the Muslims from the east. A special messenger, personal physician of Pope Philip, was to deliver the letter, although the address was of course not known. From that time, more than 300 years, the dignitaries of Christian Europe tried to find out the mystical kingdom of Priest John, which had to become a bulwark against the Muslims. Scholars and secret agents, tradesmen and diplomats, sailors and monks tried to discover this kingdom in the Far East, Central Asia, India, and at last in Ethiopia. In 20th century, the historians came to definite conclusion. It was stated that in late 40s of 11th century, in Central Asia emerged a strong Karahanid state, where many subjects were Oriental Christians, Nestorians. In 1147, the great Khan of Karahanids, Elutashi, defeated in a bloody battle the army of great Seljuk Sanjar and occupied Samarkand. This was really a fact. This news, in a distorted form, reached Europe. It was used for fabrication of above-mentioned faked letter. For many decades and even centuries, the message of Priest Jones was used as a strong propaganda remedy to boost the morale of the enemies of Islam. But in practical means, it did not work. In 1187, only 10 years after the letter of Pope Alexander III to Priest Jones, the famous general of Fatimids, Salah ad-Din, smashed in a great battle near Hittin the army of Crusaders, liberated Jerusalem, nearly annihilated the Jerusalem kingdom, united Egypt and Syria, and created the Ayyubid dynasty. This was a very important moment. The well-known Indian historian and diplomat, former ambassador to Beijing and Cairo, called the Battle of Hittin and its aftermath one of most important events in world history. The task before Salah ad-Din was not easy. Documents prove that the young king of Jerusalem, Baldwin IV, expected help from great powers of Europe and of Vatican. Salah ad-Din was well informed about this. That's why before the decisive battle, he sent a big embassy to the Islamic ruler of Spain, Al-Mansur, asking of a military alliance. In a letter, Al-Mansur was approached as Amir al-Muslimin, although before Salah ad-Din obliged, supported the spiritual caliphate of Abbasids. The ruler of Spain sent 180 big ships with soldiers, which attacked the Crusades from the rear. So the first time the successors of Umayyad and Abbasid united their forces in Mediterranean. The West answered with a new blow. In 1187, Pope Gregory VIII issued an appeal for a third crusade. A huge army from France, England, German states invaded Syria under the command of German Emperor Friedrich I Gogenstaufen, who was nicknamed Barbarossa because of his red beard. In June 1190, a day before the decisive battle with the army of Salah ed-Din, Barbarossa was drowned during the crossing of the river Salpeh. The Arabian army smashed the Crusades. The name of unhappy and drunkard leader of the Third Crusade was forgotten for nearly 800 years. But in 1940, Hitler selected for his plan of destroying Soviet Union the codename Barbarossa. He wanted to continue the task of German emperor who dreamed to conquer Orient. During the 13th century, European powers and Vatican organized five new crusades against the successors of Salah ed-Din, but they all were defeated. The prominent Russian Democrat, writer and literary critic of the 19th century, Vissarion Belinsky, described the crusaders as ignorant, selfish, lewd and profanic, blended with savage fanatism. The significance of 13th century for Asia is connected to the creation of a huge Mongol empire, which stretched from China to East Europe. The menace for Central and Western Europe was very great, but bleeding to death, Russia stopped the invaders. After the death of Genghis Khan, the empire disintegrated. In Central and Asia and Middle East emerged two great states, Golden Horde with capital at Lower Volga, and the state of Hulaguids in Iran with the capital Tabriz. Between them began a dogfight for Transcaucasia, Turkmenia, and control over the main trade routes. As a result, rulers of Golden Horde established a kind of alliance with Mamluk leaders of Egypt and partly Syria. And the Hulaguids established political and military contacts with West Europe. In this complex situation, the rulers of European states and Vatican decided to receive more information about the situation in Asia, to Central Asia and Far East, where sent ambassadors, clerics, tradesmen, secret agents, Marco Polo, Plano Carpini, Odoric, Monte Corvino, Severac, and many others. At last, they helped to have an insight, although not very truthful, in the situation in Central Asia, Far East, and so on. A mighty flotilla consisted of 13 ships, some of them armed with heavy cannons, under the command of Pedro Alvarez Cabral, started its way to the shores of India. But at the end of March, the ships came under extremely heavy storm, which continued more than 3 weeks. The 22nd of April, the land was in sight. But it was not Cape of Good Hope. It was a totally new land. The Portuguese discovered Brasilia. One of the ships was sent immediately to Lisbon to inform about the happy news. The news really was very important. Brazil became for centuries a colony of Portugal. Even today, the state language of this largest country of Latin America is Portuguese. At the end of May 1500, the Armada of Cabral was near Cape of Good Hope. But another heavy storm sent to the ground four ships, including a large one, which was under the command of Bartolomeo Dias, who rounded Africa and discovered the Cape. And there was his end. The 30th of September 1500, the squadron of Cabral arrived in Calicut. The relations between the Portuguese and local authorities were tense. The Arab and Indian population of Calicut had many skirmishes with Portuguese. Many Arab ships which were in the harbor were destroyed by Portuguese artillery. Part of the city too. In Cochin, in Kanampur, whose rulers were in bad relations with Samorin of Calicut, Cabral bought great quantities of pepper, cinnamon, and muscats. The 31st of January 1501, seven ships of Cabral's squadron returned to Lisbon. In 502, Vasco da Gama reappeared in Calicut with a fleet of 15 ships. This time he bore the pompous title Admiral of the Indian Sea. The Portuguese began by bombarding Calicut, burning down Zamorin Palace. In 1505, a Portuguese fleet of 22 ships under the command of Almeida, who had been granted the title Viceroy of India, started its journey to the Indian Ocean. It carried 1,500 officers and soldiers, of course not for defense purposes. Next year, the barbaric action of Portuguese prompted the Zamorin of Calicut to apply for aid to Ashraf al-Gawairi, Mamluk Sultan of Egypt. This was the first alliance of Hindu and Muslims against Christian invaders. In spring 1507, the Egyptian fleet, whose ships carried artillery pieces, appeared in the Arabian Sea. Admiral Mir Hussein joined the Zamorin ships off Diu Island to engage the Portuguese navy. This was the first sea battle in Indian Ocean, both sides using ships' artillery. The Portuguese fleet was defeated, but Almeida summoned all his ships and established secret contacts, with the governor of Diu Island, Malik Ayaz, who was a Christian converted to Islam. The latter refused to supply Mir Hussein's fleet with food and water. The Egyptian admiral had to divide his fleet. In these circumstances, the second battle between Egyptians and Portuguese ended in a draw. Being afraid of betrayal, Mir Hussein returned to the Red Sea. The Portuguese became masters of western part of Indian Ocean, but the main events took place in the Gulf. Early in 1506, second Portuguese squadron under Afonso Albuquerque arrived in the Red Sea. The island Socotra was occupied. The ships entered the Omani Bay, implementing the plan drawn up in Lisbon. Albuquerque had to become master of the Gulf. It is well known that for millennia, the lands and peoples of the Gulf played an important role in the history of mankind. Dilmun Empire and some other great states and events are known. Some of them are described in my book, Hegemonists and Imperialists in the Gulf, which was published in 1981 in Arabic, in English, and in Farsi. But I am afraid that in Kuwait nobody has seen the book, although it is not my fault. In context of this lecture, I will remind you only about the role of Hormuz, because it became the main object of Portuguese aggression. From 12th century, Hormuz was ruled by an Arab dynasty. When the Mongols invaded Iran and began constant attacks on Hormuz, its ruler made in 1301 a brave decision to move the citizens to a nearby island of Jerahn, now Hormuz Island. An impregnable fortress was built and the city was called New Hormuz. In 1320, Qutb ud-Din, the ruler of Hormuz, defeated the fleets of some west coast principalities, seized Bahrain, conquered Qatar and large part of Oman coast. So he received control over navigation in the Gulf and a substantial part of trade between Europe and Asia. It is known that there were three main seaways between Asia and Europe: Indo-Iranian, Indo-Mesopotamian, and Indo-Egyptian. The first two passed the waters of the new Hormuz Empire. Hormuz was ruled by, was praised by many poets and travelers. Saadi, Portuguese poet Camoens, British Milton, Russian merchant Afanasy Nikitin, and the ambassador of Timurid Shahrokh to India, Abdulrazak Samarkandi, devoted many poems and pages of their report to this island. Many of them quoted the proverb, if the earth is a golden ring, Hormuz is its jewel. But 60 years before Albuquerque entered the tried to steal this diamond, this jewel, the Gulf was visited by guests from Far East. This story is also not well known. In the middle of 14th century, after the Mongols were driven from China, the new national dynasty of Ming decided to re-establish its influence in Asia. Many tradesmen and diplomats, many missions were sent to South and Southeast Asia for this purpose. But at the end of the century, the Chinese rulers came to the conclusion that it was not sufficient. They decided to send military, political, naval expedition to the Near East and Africa. One of the reasons was, I quote, to encircle the Empire of Timur and block its military forces. The implementation of this decision was hastened after the victory of Timur over the Turks and his decision to prepare on an invasion into China. So they wanted to open the second front from the Gulf. Between 1405 and 1432, seven mighty Chinese navies visited the ports of Asia, landed in some places, army detachment, and even took part in civil wars, as for instance in Sri Lanka. Some of the squadrons had 60 big ships with more than 20,000 soldiers. All this expedition was commanded by the famous Muslim Admiral Zheng He, son and grandson of Chinese Hajis. In 1430, for the fourth voyage, a particular big armada was prepared. For its fitting, a special tax was levied in China. According to Chinese sources, it visited in 1414 Hulumusu, it is Hormuz. This time, another Muslim who spoke fluent Arabic, Mahuan, was present. In his book, Survey of Ocean Shores, he gave a detailed description of the fourth and later voyages. In 1416-1419 years, Zheng He fulfilled his fifth voyage. His ships visited African ports, Mogadishu, Malindi, Brava, Zeila, then stopped in Aden. After all that, he proceeded to Hormuz. Some of the ships visited Muscat and Kasha. Mahua and other Chinese Muslims often went ashore, discussed the possibility of a Hajj. Returning to China after his sixth voyage in 1422, Chen Ho brought to the Chinese court envoys from Hormuz and some other cities in the Gulf. After the long interval, Zhong He arrived in the Gulf in 1432. His ships stayed in Hormuz almost a year. During that time, a special mission headed by Muslim Hung Pao visited Mecca. As I mentioned, 60 years after Zheng Ho left Hormuz, the Gulf was invaded by the fleet of Afonso Albuquerque. In 1506, he attacked the ports of western part of the Gulf, which were under dominion of the ruler of Hormuz. The Portuguese assaulted Muscat. In his commentaries, it is four-volume publication, Albuquerque gives a detailed description of the destruction of the city, including burning of the magnificent mosque. Then they started the preparation for the assault on Hormuz. Under duress of merchants who were afraid of the Portuguese guns, the ruler of Hormuz, Saif ed-Din, signed in October 1507 a humiliating agreement. He agreed to become a vassal of the King of Portugal, to pay annual tribute and to grant Portuguese merchants favored treating. Henceforth, all ships sailing through the Gulf received special permission issued by the Portuguese representative in Hormuz. But soon the ruthless policy and the greed of the Portuguese made their relations with the merchant and influential group of Hormuz very tense. An uprising started, and in May 1508, Albuquerque was forced to withdraw his squadron from the Gulf. But before that, the Portuguese started the barbaric praxis to destroy cities, burn ships of Arabic merchants, kill innocent peoples, including Hajis. In 1510, Albuquerque, who was nominated Viceroy of India, occupied after second attempt Goa, which became the capital of Portuguese Empire and was in their possession up to 1961. In 1511, the Portuguese captured through violence, deceit, and treason Malacca, the greatest trade emporium in Southeast Asia, and signed in March 1514 a treaty with the founder of Safavid Iran, Shah Ismail I, a treaty according to which Iran recognized that Hormuz had become a dependency of Portugal. The Portuguese undertook to assist in shipping Iranian troops to Bahrain and Qatif. Both sides formed an alliance against the Ottoman Empire. This treaty, which really granted the Portuguese the monopoly of trade in the Gulf, was a result of crippling defeat which Iranian forces suffered in August 1514 after the bloody battle in the Chalidran plains with the Turkish army. I fully agree with the opinion of Indian diplomat Panikkar, who coined that the epoch of colonialism started after Vasco da Gama's discovery. More than 400 years, the Western scholars tried to find out who was the pilot who brought Vasco da Gama's ships from Malindi to Calicut. The old Portuguese authors named the pilot Malem or Malemo, Kana or Kanaka. They called him a Moor from Gujarat. One Arabian historian of the 16th century, Qutb ad-Din, mentioned in his work, The Ottoman Conquest of Yemen, the name of Ahmed ibn Majid. But the European scholars the Sassi and Lopez, who studied his work, didn't pay attention to this name. Only the great scholar, French scholar, Ferrand, Gabriel Ferrand, translated a sentence in the manuscript of Kutb ad-Din. I quote, "The rotten Portuguese, the people, the damned people of Franks, could not find the way from the Sea of Darkness," so the Atlantic was called, "into the Indian Ocean, till the experienced pilot Ahmed ibn Majid has shown them that way." In 1912, in his report to the Asian Society in Paris, the French scholar Gabriel Ferrand informed that he discovered in the National Library of France 37 works of Ahmed ibn Majid and another great Arabian pilot, Suleiman Mahri. One of the works of Ahmed ibn Majid was a real encyclopedia of navigation. It consisted the story of Arab navigation and perfect sailing direction of the Gulf, Red Sea, Indian Ocean, up to Indonesia. Because of hundreds of sea geographic and astronomic terms in medieval Arabic, Ferrand considered that to create a scholar translation with commentaries would be impossible. But in 1970, the British expert Tibbets published in London the translation of Kitab of Fuwaid by Ahmad bin Majid of Najd. In 1985, well-known Russian scholar Theodor Shumovsky published in Moscow the full translation of the navigation encyclopedia of Ahmed ibn Majid, Kitab of Fuwaid, with exceptional useful commentaries, which are four times longer than the encyclopedia itself. Shumovsky, who devoted all his life to studying and translation of the works of Ahmed ibn Majid, is of opinion that the translation of Tibbets is not of highest scholar standards. The opinion of Shumovsky is of importance because he discovered in Petersburg, translated and published in 1957 in Russian with scholar commentaries, the last work of Ahmed ibn Majid, his three Urjurs under the title Three Unknown Sailing Directives. I am proud to remind that the first reviews of Shumovsky's book was published in Kuwait, where a special conference in the 60s took place. In the second half of the first Urjus, Ahmed ibn Majid writes, "The Portuguese arrived in the year 906 of Hijra. It means 1501 to Calicut. They sold and bought. They governed and oppressed, relying on the bribed chiefs, Samiri. They brought with them hatred to Islam. Oh, if I would know what it would be." In his Ujurs, Ahmed mentions the epoch of Islamic glory, the Abbasid Caliphate. He reminds his readers that in the 12th century, there were three famous sailors, Muhammad ibn Shisan, Sahal ibn Alan, and Saiz ibn Kahlan. He calls them three lions of the sea. And after reminding his grandfather and father, who were also pilots, he describes his life work and says that he is the fourth of lions of the sea, really the last. These publications, the publication of his encyclopedia and his three Urjurs, are extremely important because up to the beginning of 20th century, all the world thought that the only encyclopedia, naval encyclopedia and sea encyclopedia, which existed in Islamic world, was written by the Turkish Admiral Sidi Ali Çelebi in 554, under the topic Muhat. Sidi Ali Çelebi is a very interesting person. He was a Turkish admiral. He was sent by the Sultan Suleiman to Basra to bring Turkish ships which were blocked by the Portuguese back to Cairo, to Alexandria. But after the difficult fight with the Portuguese and after a terrible storm, Sidi Ali arrived in Gujarat and stayed there for 8 months. During his stay, he studied the works of Ahmed ibn Majid. And he based his encyclopedia on the works of Ahmed ibn Majid and Suleiman al-Mahdi. After that, he went, the Turkish admiral, to Delhi, where he was met by his Emperor Humayun of Great Mughals, and the meeting was so important that Humayun sent 1,000 high-posted officials and 300 elephants to meet him. After prolonged discussion, he gave him a letter to the Sultan Suleiman. Çelebi decided with his work to go to Turkey via Central Asia and Astrakhan. And I discovered in old Russian archives the story of his visiting the vicinity of Astrakhan. The fight was there in 1556. The armies of Ivan IV, the Terrible, occupied Astrakhan. So Çelebi had to return, but not to Delhi, but to Iran. And he had discussion with Iranian Shah Ismail and brought a second letter to Suleiman, Sultan Suleiman, this time from the Safavid Shah. So with both these letters, he arrived in Ottoman Empire. And this his publication was used as an example of the greatest achievements of Turkish military, naval strategy and history. And now, one important thing I want to stress. I think it is important. I heard sometimes that, look, Ahmed ibn Majid betrayed the Arabs. He opened the way to the Portuguese. So why should we think or commemorate Ahmed ibn Majid? I consider it totally incorrect. The great achievements of Ahmed ibn Majid is the history of Arabic Arabic voyages, of Arabic shipments, of Arabic contacts during 2,000 years between Asia and Far East and Middle East. He introduced the whole naval history of Abbasid. He opened not only for the West, but for the Arabs, their glory. And this is of great importance. Thank you.